Welcome to the excitement of NHL tonight. Don't say it's the offseason. Not when there's this much exciting stuff going on. Tony Loughman alongside Kevin Weeks. Are you into recycling?
Yes.
Reduce, reuse, recycle?
Absolutely.
The concept of, right? Let's say back in the day you had something and it went away. Would you bring it back?
Perhaps, depending.
You know where I'm going.
I certainly do.
The Anaheim Ducks. In 2011, they fired Randy Carlyle. Today, they rehired Randy Carlyle. 2007 Stanley Cup, it'll be the 10-year anniversary. Next season, Carlyle rejoining the team he took to the top of the mountain. What's it going to be like to go back to a team he's already coached? He addressed it.
Well, exactly. I talked about it in the press conference, right after the press conference, that the first 10 people that I met walking into the building were either people that I had to shake their hand or hug them. So it was very familiar territory to come in. A lot hasn't changed, but yet a lot has, you know, in the hockey world. And I just feel very, very fortunate to be given this opportunity.
Randy, how about for you? You talked earlier today about making changes and evolving as a coach. How have you changed since your last stint in Anaheim?
Well, I think I'm a lot more mellow. As I've stated before, I've been 40 plus years now around the game. There's things that are going to happen that you probably would have made a poor decision a while back, but you've learned from it, and you always try to steal from what other people are doing. And when you sit back and watch what's going on and how teams are playing and the approach people are taking, it forces you to change. If you're not willing to change, then you're going to get pushed by the wayside.
Randy, what was the process like for you to go through this with Bob Murray? After all, you've worked closely with Bob Murray. Heck, Bob Murray let you go several years back. What was the process like, and why do you think you're the right guy for this job?
Well, again, the comfort zone, number one, with the hockey club. This is a good team. This isn't a team that you're stepping into and looking at a rebuild. First half of the season, they didn't win enough games. In the last half, I don't know if there was any teams that were better. And as far as Bob Murray is concerned, when things like this happen in pro sports, he was a friend. Obviously, that changes a little bit when a guy lets you go. It takes some time to get over those things. But in reality, if you're in pro sports, specifically if you're a coach, you better be prepared to deal with this type of adversity and move on.
Randy, you mentioned you got a great team there, but what's been missing in Anaheim? What do they need to get to the next level?
I think that the accountability, the structure, all those things are going to be things that we're going to try and reinforce. But again, I think they have to play the game to a higher pace. The pace of the game has gotten away from them, and they were chasing the game versus taking control of it.
Excellent interview with Stephen EJ on NHL Live. A lot of interesting topics brought about both by the press conference and that interview. What was your immediate reaction when you heard Carlyle would be back in charge of the Ducks?
Well, I think it was a case of some familiarity, certainly for Bob Murray. And Bob Murray's done an outstanding job with the Ducks. You look at what he's been able to do over the years. For some reason, in the last little while, they've had a lot of really good teams, but they haven't been able to get over the hump. And I would certainly say that, in speaking to different players in that room, when you look at this team that they've had in place, there's no reason to expect, based on how good they've been, based on how consistent they've been, at times how dominant they've been as well, that they haven't been able to take the next step. So this is a case of familiarity for the Anaheim Ducks and tabbing somebody that they know in Randy Carlyle. He gets the opportunity to re-enter in a place where he coached before. As you guys have been pointing out and we talked about, a lot has changed in Anaheim. Same building, same location of the building. Of course, you get some of the incumbents, and of course, Bob Murray's still in charge and everything else. But from a player personnel standpoint, only two guys remain. So I think that there are a lot of changes in Anaheim since his original tenure. And this being his second go-around, what I'm interested to see, and you heard him talk about it in the interview, is the game continues to change. The game's always evolving. And some things in the game quite simply don't change. There are some fundamental elements of the game that will always be in place, but other things have changed. You look at the way Chicago plays. You look at the way Tampa plays. You look at some of the things that you've seen from the Pittsburgh Penguins here and some of the other teams in the last while that have had a lot of success. So I'm sure that Randy Carlyle's had a lot of time to see some of those things, digest, and perhaps then say, okay, which of these things am I going to incorporate? Because keep in mind, the league's younger than it's ever been. We have a lot of young, bright minds that are playing the game right now. The way in which they process and also interpret information and assimilate information is very different. So that'll be a challenge. I'm interested to see how that's going to go. But, hey, one thing we do know, the Ducks do have a good core there.
Oh, without a doubt, four straight Pacific Division crowns. For the Ducks, there's only two players, as you pointed out, Corey Perry and Ryan Getzlaff, that returned from that 07 Cup team, which was led by Carlisle. He also had the experience in Toronto, which we know can be just a crucible, a frying pan. Going back to Anaheim this time around, why will it be different?
I think it will be different, or it needs to be different. That's the real key, because of the evolution that we talked about. You look at all the teams around you that continue to get better. I mean, last time when he was coaching Anaheim, we saw what their team did. You mentioned the fact, the 07 Cup and everything else. Oh, well, sorry. The LA Kings have just won two Stanley Cups, and they are a state rival, and they're just down the 405. Okay, sorry, the San Jose Sharks just got to a Stanley Cup final. And you continue to look around, and you just see the way in which the game is played. The league's younger. You look at the pace game. The Anaheim Ducks like to play a possession game. They play what a lot of people refer to as a heavy game, but they certainly don't play a fast game. And one person that helped them push the pace to play the fast game in
Anaheim.
In Anaheim, Lloyd, easy for me to say, and Carl Hagelin, it's off season, but it's not really off season. Lloyd, but in Carl Hagelin, you look at what he was able to do. Look at what Hagelin did in Pittsburgh.
Wow.
So yeah, you still have a speed merchant in Cogliano, but you don't have Hagelin. And for whatever reason, Hagelin, they thought, and he wasn't a fit there, so do they try to get a little faster? How do they approach it? That's what I'm interested to really see.
Great point.
With this Ducks team.
That came up again and again in the press conference, because everybody, it's a copycat league,
sure,
everybody just saw what the Pens did. Bob Murray raved about their forwards. Mm. When I think of the Pens, I think about their depth at goalie, which I know pleases you.
Sure.
Matt Murray, Marc-Andre Fleury. These Ducks, as you've pointed out many times, have two outstanding goalies on their roster. How does this coaching change impact John Gibson and Freddie Anderson?
I think it's what will the organizational direction be? What's the blueprint? I think Anaheim finds himself in an outstanding position. Why? You do have the American out of Pittsburgh and John Gibson, but you do have the Great Dane and Freddie Anderson. And I think Freddie Anderson's a little bit more advanced right now, a little more mature, certainly a touch older. But listen, this is an amazing 1-2 punch. I've said it. It's the best young 1-2 punch in the world right now that the Anaheim Ducks have. But keep in mind, they've got Gibson under contract, Freddie Anderson, and Gibson was an all-star this year. On the left of your screen, Freddie Anderson is not under contract. What does that mean? Are they looking at re-signing Freddie Anderson? If they re-sign Freddie Anderson, will they then entertain the possibility of trading John Gibson? I'm not sure, but I've been told that that may be a possibility. Mm. Or do they say, okay, we're going to move Freddie Anderson and we're going to just hitch our wagon to Gibson because he's been our guy ever since we drafted him out of Kitchener in the OHL. Either way, it makes for a great situation, but it's going to have to be managed and managed in a way that's beneficial to the organization. I would say this, they have an outstanding tandem, as we talked about. I think both these guys are stars and superstars in waiting, so to speak. But who's playing in playoffs? Who's on first? Who's on second? You know what I mean? What's on third? And there's been a lot of that go on the last couple years. I think that's been a little bit mismanaged from that standpoint. But two great assets. There are a lot of teams that are hungry and thirsty for goalies and upgrading at their goal position right now. Let's say at Dallas Stars. Let's say at Calgary Flames. I mean, we can go around the league. There are a lot of opportunities, I believe, for them to be able to trade one of these guys if they so choose. I wouldn't be surprised if they make a move here with one of their goalies going elsewhere. I know they can net them a great return.
Oh, no doubt. I like that you weaved in some Abbott and Costello. Who's
there
on
you
first,
go.
What's on
yeah.
second? While we're on the top,
sure.
Great duos. How about the St. Louis Blues? Mm. Their coach next year in his last year as the bench boss of the Blues, Ken Hitchcock. Coach in waiting, Mike Yeo. How about this situation? Associate head coach, and he will become the head coach of the St. Louis Blues for the 17-18 season. How is this going to work?
I'm not sure. It's a really unique approach. I haven't seen this happen. I really think that they identify Mike Yeo as a younger coach, which he is, and they're looking at the fact that he can continue to grow. I think it also affords, from their standpoint, they're looking at this being an opportunity for Mike Yeo to continue to grow as a head coach and do that while not under the gun, but to be able to get some of the coaching experience from a Ken Hitchcock. So I can understand it from that standpoint, but it does present a real unique structure. It does present a real unique look and feel in the locker room and perhaps on the bench. But make no mistake about it, Ken Hitchcock's had an outstanding coaching resume. And for Mike Yeo, he's going to have to play a little bit more of a patient game until he has this team himself. not this upcoming season, but the season after that. St. Louis Blues had an outstanding season. I'm going to say this right now. For all that the Blues had to overcome and being injury ravaged, and I've spoken to Ken Hitchcock, Kirk Muller throughout the course of the season, different players in their group, what they were able to accomplish in light of all the injuries that they sustained is nothing short of incredible. It really is. Insert Robbie Fabry. How great of a year did Robbie Fabry have? Colton Parayko, the same thing. Edmondson on the back end. Both goalies were outstanding. And although both had injuries at different times, I mean, you go up and down. Steen had been hurt at different times. There are a lot of key players in that Blues team that were injured. So I'm interested to see how this looks with the new coaching staff, number one.
Right.
And I'm interested to see how the new coaching staff has an impact on how this team plays in the upcoming season.
Let's focus in on the dynamic involved in having a coach in waiting, because when a coach takes over a team, it comes down to, well, what's his style going to be? We know the way a Hitch coach team plays. We've seen it for years and years. We know how a Yo coach team plays. Are they a good fit to go back-to-back, 1 year of Hitch, then 1 year of Yo, or will there be some adjustment there?
I think there will be some adjustment, but a lot of it is going to be predicated on how St. Louis wants to play. What do they want to be known as? We saw them as a heavy team with some skill. They have an outstanding defensive core. Does Shattenkirk get traded? Does that change some of the mobility that you have on the back end? I would definitely say so. If they trade a Shattenkirk, do they want to continue to be a heavy skill team, or do they want to become faster and get some younger legs and integrate some of the younger players into the group? What happens with the captain, David Backes? He's a pending unrestricted free agent. Does he stay there? Is he in Minnesota? Is Troy Brouwer there? Is Troy Brouwer re-signed? He's a pending UFA. Or is he back home up in Vancouver? Or do they resign him and he's the new captain? I think a lot of these things will come into play in terms of the personnel that's going to impact their style of play this year and also going forward.
Very interesting to see the way it all works out. A lot of moving pieces. Mm-hmm. The hockey world is still reeling from the loss of the great Mr. Hockey, Gordie Howe. His life celebrated today at the Joe. The funeral, obviously, a part of the experience as well. A very challenging time for those that loved and followed the great number nine. Our J.P. Morosi on the scene for NHL Network.
Thousands of fans, friends, and mourners came here to Joe Louis Arena on Tuesday to pay respects to Gordie Howe, Mr. Hockey. Wayne Gretzky, the great one, was among them. Gretzky was here at 9 a.m. when the visitation began. According to Dave Stubbs, our colleague at NHL.com, Gretzky was among the pallbearers that guided Howe's casket to its place where it lied in state on the arena floor at Joe Louis. Gretzky said of all the honors he's had in his life, including welcoming Queen Elizabeth to Canada, lighting the Olympic torch in Vancouver, and meeting Pope John Paul II, serving as a pallbearer today was among his greatest honors. Gretzky said simply that Gordie Howe was the greatest hockey player who ever lived and the nicest man he ever met. Gretzky also spoke about Howe's legacy in growing the game of hockey in the United States.
Gordie Howe, in a lot of ways, made hockey popular in the United States. Up until the 40s and 50s, it was basically looked upon as sort of Montreal, Toronto, the West, Alberta, British Columbia. Gordie Howe coming to Detroit really changed sort of the landscape of hockey itself in the United States. And I don't think that the NHL is going to overlook the fact of how important he was to the game. So I'm sure they're going to do something real special for him. You know, not everybody gets to meet their hero or their idol. And sometimes when you meet them, it wasn't as good as you thought it was going to be. And man, I got so lucky that the guy I chose happened to be so special. So I got to play my first game against Gordie. I was 17. And I was so nervous, you know, to actually be on the ice with him and play against him. He was winking at me the whole warm-up. And I thought, wow, this is pretty cool. Gordie Howe, he's winking at me. I took the puck from him about the second or third shift, and all of a sudden I got a whack on the thumb. I thought I broke my thumb. And he said, don't ever take the puck from me again. I was like, okay. So in the locker room, we had an old goaltender named Gary Smith that was our goalie. And I said, Gary, I don't know what just happened. I said, you know, Gordie was winking at me the whole warm-up, and he tried to break my thumb. He's like, winking at you? He's not winking at you. He's got a bad blinking problem. I said, well, why didn't somebody tell me? I thought he was wishing me good luck.
Fans came from as far away as Texas and Ohio, and many dignitaries attended as well, including Scotty Bowman, Steve Yzerman, and even Detroit Tigers great Al Kaline.
Gordy always wanted to come out and take batting practice, so one day he got out there and started swinging and struggled a little bit, naturally so. He probably never played much baseball or softball in his day, but finally was able to hit a ball out of the ballpark. And I tell you what, the expression on his face looked like he just won the Stanley Cup.
Simply, he's just a really nice man, actually. Like, I think the first time I actually met him was just down the hall walking when I was drafted. My first year, literally walking down to the locker room, and a small group of people, which included Gordy, walking by, and he just walked up, introduced himself, shook my hand, and just, as he does with everyone, took some time to talk, tell a couple stories about when he was 18 years old. And from that point on, I mean, just a nice man who is always thoughtful.
I got an opportunity to meet Gordy, and it was something that, you know, you just the way he carried himself, the way he interacted, the way he treated people, you know, it just kind of showed you, you know, obviously why he meant so much to the game of hockey and to the Red Wing organization.
The mood on the Joe Louis Arena floor was understandably somber, but also deeply appreciative for Howe's legacy here in Detroit and around the hockey world. Howe's number 9 was brought down from the rafters and flanked by the 4 Stanley Cup championship banners he won in Detroit. Also prominently displayed were 3 jerseys from the Houston Aeros, worn by Howe and his 2 sons, Mark and Marty. His funeral mass will be Wednesday morning at 11 a.m. at the Cathedral of the Blessed Sacrament here in downtown Detroit. The church is located on Woodward Avenue, a familiar parade route for the Red Wings' several Stanley Cup celebrations in recent years. And years from now, not far from here, passengers from Detroit to Windsor and back will be able to cross between the U.S. and Canada on the Gordie Howe International Bridge.
Wonderful stuff, as always, from J.P. Morosi, celebrating the life of Mr. Hockey. We'll have live coverage starting at 10 a.m. Eastern on Wednesday of that funeral. You use the word transcendent to describe Gordie Howe. So everything that's followed is what would follow for a head of state, a president, somebody of that ilk, because he was that special to so many. He played hockey, but he was so much more than a hockey player. Special stuff there.
I think that's perfectly said, because although he goes down as one of the, if not arguably the greatest player to ever play, he was also equally a great person, a great humanitarian. And you heard our great Wayne Gretzky talk about that. And really, a lot of us are here because we are able to stand on the shoulders of giants that came before us. So I really think that it's fitting to have the likes of a Steve Yzerman and Chris Draper and Wayne Gretzky and so many other dignitaries that have come out to pay their respects, either privately and publicly, to Gordie Howe for all that he meant to the great Detroit Red Wing franchise, but also to this great game and being one of the real forefathers of our game to help elevate the game to not only where he was able to take it to then, but where it's come to now based on the strength of that. So I was fortunate enough to have a chance to play a game with him, as I talked about when I played in the IHL with the Detroit Vipers. He was then 69 years old, if I remember correctly, and just having him in the locker room, just for us to be able to look and say, oh my gosh, that's Gordie Howe, and he's actually shooting on us in practice and the rest of it. It was a real unique opportunity for us and certainly a privilege for all of us. So he'll be forever missed, but as I said, not forgotten. His legacy will live on.
Yeah, part of that legacy is how bright the future is for the entire National Hockey League. Speaking of the future, when we come back on NHL Tonight, how about the future for the 2 teams that played in the 2016 Stanley Cup? Sharks, Pens, what's next for those teams? We hit that straight ahead. It will never get old for Penguins fans to watch this team celebrate. What a journey for the 2016 Pittsburgh Penguins, coming from all the way down at 12th in the standings to win the Cup in June. How about the sights and sounds from that Game 6?
Game 6 of the Stanley Cup Final with the Cup in the building. Nothing less than the most important in San Jose franchise history.
It's been a marathon for both clubs. Tonight will mark each team's 106th game. If Pittsburgh wins, they'll hoist the Cup. If San Jose emerges, they'll meet up for number 107.
Whipped it across to Dumoulin. Waits. Fires. Score! And it's 1-0.
Right back at it. Right back at it. Come on, boys. Play in the red. Let's go.
They must play at center. Played right back across, and here's Couture. Save, score!
Our period here. Our period.
So Shears goes and hunts that puck, he banks it back to me.
They're going to the net.
Huh?
They're going to the net.
Both?
Yeah.
Threw it in front. Hornquist is there in the battle. Crosby to Letang. He shoots. He scores. It's Letang. It's 2-1.
Let's go.
Crew, the goosebumps stuff. What a fascinating look inside to be able to hear the voices on the ice. We saw Chris Letang there score the cup clinching goal. He was absent on media day. Disappointing for a lot of us who were looking forward to asking 58 questions. Turns out the reason he was absent was he had surgery that day for an infection. You got to be kidding me that the guy played that well after having a surgery the day before the cup final.
Incredible. It really is. I mean, especially for somebody like Chris Letang, whose game is predicated on his skating ability. An exceptional skater. And we saw it especially in the elimination game in Game 6 in San Jose. His ability to skate, his mobility, his edge work, edge control, all with the zone entry pass. And here's the goal I talked about. Look at this. That whole shift was dominant, and that was all related right back to his skating. Letang was outstanding. He had an incredible season. This, too, is somebody that's been able to overcome some major illnesses.
Stroke. My goodness.
Some major injuries. And just to add to that, the simple fact that he had that procedure done, listen, this is what makes hockey players. And with all due respect to a lot of the other men and women that are great athletes out there in their respective disciplines, there's something unique about hockey players. Their pain threshold, mental toughness, psychological toughness, and fortitude are second to none.
Amen to that. How about the mental toughness it took to be a goalie for the Pittsburgh Penguins? On the one hand, you're Matt Murray. You're playing an amazing level of hockey, earning more wins in the postseason than you did in the regular season. And then the guy over on the bench, well, he led the team to the Cup in 09, and you think he's headed for the Hall of Fame in Marc-Andre Fleury. How about that situation, that you've got two goalies that are that good on the roster going into next year? How do the Pens handle it?
Well, I'll tell you one thing. This is a unique situation for the Pittsburgh Penguins because they're that good on the ice and they're that good as people. And those are two things that shone through for me. Matt Murray, in only a second-year pro, was downright dominant, shredded up the American League, came up to the NHL, and, well, we see what he was able to do. Marc-Andre Fleury had an amazing season. At certain points in the year, when you look at the numbers, they were Vezina Trophy worthy to some extent. I mean, 60 games played, 35-18, 2-3-0, and a 9-20, and five shutouts. He had an incredible season. Had it not been for the concussions, perhaps we wouldn't have seen Matt Murray, but this is a real great situation for their former goalie and current GM, Jim Rutherford, as well, where the Pittsburgh Penguins have Marc-Andre Fleury, as I've talked about, who I believe is on the road to being in the Hall of Fame. He's at 350 regular season wins. If he gets another 150 wins, that's 500 wins. He would only be the third person in the 500 win club, not named Marty Brodeur at one and not named Patrick Waugh at two. And Fleury's 32 years old. He's got a fairly cap-friendly deal just based on his body of work and his list of accomplishments to date. But one thing about Marc-Andre Fleury, and I hope that this serves as a lesson for a lot of other goalies at different levels, very seldom, if ever, have I ever seen a star goalie respond the way that Marc-Andre Fleury responds. Sometimes when you're a backup, you have to eat it, and there's certain things that you can't say or you can't show or you can't demonstrate or you just choose not to for the betterment of your team. But to have the resume like Marc-Andre Fleury, to be as supportive of Matt Murray as he was, to be as encouraging, and I talked to Matt Murray about this, he raved about Marc-Andre Fleury. And for Fleury to be the way he was to Zatkoff and to, of course, Matt Murray, tells me everything you need to know. Everybody's a good guy when things are going their way. But when you don't get the lion's share and you're forced to take a different role and you see somebody else succeeding in your absence, it shows a lot about his character. I'm beyond blown away by how he handled it. And Matt Murray, this guy's a potential future star. So the Pittsburgh Penguins are going to have some decisions to make this offseason. Do they wait, Tone, potentially, and then say, okay, well, if Las Vegas ends up coming in, can we hold on to Marc-Andre Fleury and then maybe leave him unprotected in that expansion draft? Or do you try to be a little bit proactive and do you make a deal sooner rather than later? He has a limited no-move clause. It's only 12 teams. So I'm interested to see how this goes. It's going to take some creativity on both sides. But one way I do know for sure, it's really an embarrassment of riches, oh, if you will.
Great
There's
problem
no
to have.
Embarrassment.
Yeah.
There's no embarrassment, but yeah, that's really
the case.
You have
to go back to 97 and 98 for the last time a cup winner repeated. It was the Wings. This Penguins team, when you look at their roster and their UFAs and their RFAs, pretty much the same group is coming back next year. This is it. Seriously, this is it. Schultz, Lovejoy, Cullen, Bennett, Zatkoff. The rest of the players on the roster, not listed here, are back. How good does it feel to be Mike Sullivan right now and Jim Rutherford?
I think it feels great. And if you're Mike Sullivan and Jim Rutherford, you were able to hit home runs because you had an entire team. You did an outstanding job in cap management. You did an outstanding job in your asset development in the form of your prospects. Oh, by the way, four or five of them that ended up coming up to be players, including your head coach.
Right.
Not to mention, you made some bold moves like acquiring a Phil Kessel. I talked to Jim Rutherford about it. We spoke to him about it, of course, on Media Day as well. And quite simply, Jim Rutherford was able to look into the eyes and ultimately in the soul of Phil Kessel and see Phil Kessel the way no one else in the world saw him. No one. Nobody in hockey. Nobody in NHL hockey. And pull that deal off, which was an amazing deal. And then you go from there. You already have your key pillars in place. You have Marc-Andre Fleury. You have Chris Letang already under contract, Malkin and Sidney Crosby. But then you complement them with the likes of a Kessel. You also bring in, you have Bonino and these guys that are a part of it. You bring in a Carl Hagelin as well. You bring in Trevor Daley, the second leading minute guy in terms of minutes played on your back end. And now you start building out a team. The best part that you pointed out, I mean, of course, I think Ben Lovejoy was outstanding. He played really well. Ian Cole, underrated player on the team. Matt Cullen that we just showed, 16 regular season goals. Fifth most playoff games all time.
Played with a broken toe since game two.
Fifth most playoff games played all time. And we're going to trust you to go up against Jumbo, Thornton, Pavelski, and Hurdle in any D-zone or neutral zone face-off, all playoff, all Stanley Cup final long. So I really think they need to find a way to re-sign Matt Cullen for sure. But this is an outstanding job of building your team from within, strategic additions via trade, and doing a great job of drafting and developing your players.
We talked about Matt Cullen's age a lot, 39 years old and 10 years removed from his last cup, because age is significant in the NHL. It's a youth league, it's a speed league, and because of that, we pivot and we talk about the Sharks, third oldest team in the National Hockey League based on average age, according to NHLNumbers.com. This is concerning to some. What's your take as you look at it?
Well, I think the San Jose Sharks have made it known that they want to become a younger team, and they've made some efforts to become younger. So when you look at what they've been able to do, their core group is older. Of course, we've seen that in Jumbo Thornton, Patrick Marleau, is he back? Brent Burns, 31 years old, and a Norris Trophy candidate, and deservedly so. But they're starting to, when you look from left to right here, Dana Zubras, Marleau, Thornton, the rest of them, they are a little bit older. Now, I don't think that the performance was necessarily due to age in terms of them not winning the Stanley Cup. Paul Martin was an amazing addition, partnered with Brent Burns. Joel Ward was outstanding, clutch. Joel Thornton had an amazing year again, and we can go up and down. But I do think they're going to want to continue to infuse some new players into this group. Perhaps a Timo Meier draws in next year. We saw Matt Nieto. You look at even Wingles, like some of the other Tierney, 21 years old. They have some younger guys in their group as well. Martin Jones on the back end is a young goalie who was outstanding and is going to grow with this group. But all things being equal, they're going to want to continue to just sprinkle in some young players. And Doug Wilson was very public about that the last 2 years, saying we need to get younger, we want to get faster. Logan Couture playing a bigger role now and maybe taking some of that leadership and some of the production perhaps away from somebody like a Patrick Marleau, who is so highly revered as he should be, and deservedly so, being the longest tenured San Jose Shark. So I think there'll be some tweaks in their group. I wouldn't be surprised to see some tweaks, but you want to talk about having an offseason and what Jimmy Rutherford was able to do. What about what Doug Wilson was able to do? Look at the players that he added to this group and even acquiring James Reimer down the stretch.
How about that? How about Reimer and Jones? And what do you do going forward there? Because Reimer could be a sought-after goalie. We saw once he left Toronto, and even his numbers in Toronto.
Sure, 920 save percentage in
Toronto.
Very
respectable. And Martin Jones, what a find. That
Steal.
Was a backup.
Steal.
The guy who backed him up, though, tremendous confidence in Reimer. There was the meltdown against the Bruins in Game 7. Obviously, that looms. But that's years ago.
Sure.
Reimer, how much of a weapon can he be?
I really think that James Reimer, if I'm Doug Wilson, I'm trying to find a way to re-sign him. That's what I'm trying to do, because you look at Reimer's numbers, and not to mention, of course there's a good market for James Reimer. If I'm looking at him on anybody on that board, I would make the case that James Reimer would be the most favorable guy and the most attractive guy to me as an opposing general manager. So if I'm Doug Wilson, I see what the marketplace is, and I'm going to do everything to retain him, and I'm going to tell you why. You don't have to overextend Marty Jones. You can start Marty Jones 58 games. You can start Reimer. I'm sure James Reimer, and knowing him from Toronto, he has aspirations of being a one again. But I'm just saying, I would make the best pitch I can if I'm San Jose. Is that number 2-5? Is it 2-7-5? Is it 3? Is it a 2-year deal? Is it a 3-year deal? I'm not sure. But imagine that tandem being intact one more year. Very rarely, if ever, will San Jose get out goaltended if that's their tandem. Marty Jones, I believe, is a star in the making. We saw everything from him in this season.
No doubt.
We saw everything from him in the playoffs. He was all world in the Stanley Cup final as well. James Reimer had a few shutouts for the Sharks down the stretch. I think it's a really nice luxury item to have, and one that you don't necessarily have to overpay for the way the Dallas Stars have done with their 1-2 combo.
And we look forward, if you're the Sharks, some looming decisions,
yes,
some big name, big ticket items mm-hmm. are going to come off the books after next season. I'm talking about Jumbo, Patrick Marleau, Brent Burns, Tommy Wingles. The numbers on that bottom line, that's a lot of money that comes off the cap after next season. Decisions to be made. I didn't work in the NHL, but I feel confident
you do now.
That Brent Burns is going to make an obscene amount of money, and he's earned it with the way he's played and the kind of production he's given them from the back end. How do you see this playing out?
Well, I think that you looked at that. You look at Brent Burns and all that he's been able to do for this team ever since coming to San Jose. You want me to play forward? Cool. I can be a star there. You want to put me on deep? Cool. I can be a star there. No big deal. And I think that he is one of their key foundational pieces. I think it would be extremely prudent of them to go ahead and sign him to an extension as soon as possible. Now, in the case of Joel Thornton, you look at the age, but you still see the production. And you still see the class. And you see all the deliverables and all the intangibles there. All right, you look at Patrick Marleau. Is this a case where Patrick Marleau wants a trade? I'm not necessarily sure. He loves playing in San Jose, longest tenured Shark. Quite frankly, I don't necessarily know that they move him either. So they've got some business to take care of, though, no question. But it starts with Brent Burns.
And a note about the business off the ice. According to the Associated Press, the NHL has decided on Las Vegas as the home of its next franchise, provided organizers can come up with a $500 million fee. The Vegas expansion team, according to the AP report, will begin play for the 2017-18 season and will be the league's 31st franchise and the first major sports team to call Las Vegas home. When we come back on NHL Tonight, Sidney Crosby will be heading to Las Vegas. He's already picked up quite a bit of hardware in June. Will he earn more? We'll talk about that next.
The siren sounds, and Braden Holtby has tied Martin Brodeur.
Why don't they just split a skate, Joe? That'll be fun.
I don't know what to say about Burns. Unbelievable, hard to handle. He shoots the puck about 10 times a game. He's a dynamic player.
World junior gold, two Olympic golds, world championship gold, and now two Stanley Cups and a Conn Smythe.
A picture, and it's his.
Yeah!
What do those guys do for an encore? After a great season and playoffs, they go to Vegas for the NHL Awards Wednesday, June 22nd, pre- and post-coverage on NHL Network for the very best of the National Hockey League. The show, of course, will be hosted by Will Arnett. Lots of interest in who will win these awards. These are the awards that, when a career is over, we talk about. And throughout a player's career, we talk about, is he underappreciated, underrated? This is where we find out how everybody is viewed. The Hart Trophy, The Most Valuable Player Award in the National Hockey League has never been won by an American-born player. Jamie Benn, Sidney Crosby, both Canadians. The guy on the other side of the screen is from Buffalo, New York. Who wins, Weeksy?
A lot of love for all three, man. This is going to be tough, UNHL fans, but I'm going Buffalo, New York's Patrick Kane. This guy was able to author what was an incredible season. Very difficult circumstances to start it, but man, was he dominant. And that line, simply, they made plays up and down the ice. Him, Panarin, Anisimov made plays from the left, made plays from the right, off the rush, off the cycle. One thing that didn't matter is these guys lit up the score sheet each and every game. And Patrick Kane, I can't believe the first American ever in our great league on the cusp of the centennial to win the Art Ross Trophy. I can't believe it.
26-game point streak was unbelievable. Must-see TV throughout the early part of the season. The Vezina, presented annually to the best goalie in the National Hockey League. Braden Holtby's 48 wins tied that iconic mark set by Martin Brodeur. Ben Bishop, Jonathan Quick, three outstanding candidates. Who's your pick?
Three deserving, two American to the right, and Braden Holtby from out Western Canada on the left. I had Holtby before. I'm giving Ben Bishop the nudge.
What?
I'm giving Ben Bishop the nudge. And every one of them has a strong case. However, in the case of Ben Bishop, let me tell you something, Tone. He was able to do this. Look at the injuries this team sustained this season. Look at the key guys that weren't going. Look at when Tampa was struggling at points in the season. This guy was downright dominant. Stolen wins, consistent performance, handled the puck. It's a heartbreak for me to have to say, but I got to be totally objective. I think Ben Bishop gets it by a nose hair.
I remember seeing John Cooper plead his case very effectively, advocating for Bishop. And you can't make a wrong decision among those three. Interesting choice by you. How about the Calder? The Rookie of the Year Award. This is a fascinating one because before the season began, the generational talent, Connor McDavid, a lot of people thought it was a foregone conclusion. The Ghost came on strong and you were on top of that.
You know
but
it.
But the Breadman, this is it. Another category with great choices. Who gets the nod from
me? I'm going to go to the bread man. You know why? Let me tell you this here, right? I remember talking to Stan Bowman at last year's Stanley Cup final. Weeksy, we signed this kid out of Russia. Oh, yeah, it looks like he's pretty good. A right-handed version of Patrick Kane looks eerily similar to Patrick Kane. And I remember speaking to them when they came into New York. I asked Anisimov, hey, Artie, why do you guys play so well? Oh, we play Russian style. Okay, well, it looks like they're playing Russian style. It looks like they're playing a dominant style. And Panarin made a seamless transition to the NHL. Yes, he played in the KHL before, but some of the folks I spoke to in the KHL said if there was a team that he would be best suited to play with, it would be the Chicago Blackhawks. And they know Russian a lot better than me. And they were right.
They were certainly right.
And as was Gagarin Cup.
How about the Norris? The defensemen obviously have been getting a lot of attention with Brent Burns playing so well in the Cup final. Drew Doughty, Eric Carlson, the other finalists. Who do you like?
Two California men out left and the nation's capital of Canada in Ottawa back on the right. All it's outstanding, Drew Doughty. If there was a year that Drew Doughty was overall dominant, it was this year. Because I love what Drew Doughty brings to the table in terms of his physicality and his ability to defend and play big minutes. But I want to see him light up the score sheet. This year he had 51 points. That's where he should be based on his skill, his hockey IQ, his time on ice, and everything else. So this to me was the most complete season that we've seen so far from Drew Doughty, and that's why I think he's deserving. The plus 24 rating, the 51 points. Everybody's been talking about it. He's been great. Two Olympic golds, two Stanley Cups. But I wanted a little bit more because I think he's that sick. He was that sick this year.
And you think he'll get the Norris? How about the Jack Adams? Because there were a number of coaches that had outstanding seasons. Gerard Gallant, Lindy Ruff, Barry Trotz with the Caps, the President's Trophy. Who comes away with the Jack Adams?
I'm going to say Coach Trotz. And I like the way our producer, JB, mentioned it in the pregame meeting. Just his take on what Coach Trotz was able to accomplish this year. But I think it was a tremendous season for him. It was a dominant, historic season for the Washington Capitals. Tone, these guys won in so many different ways. They were able to play the heavy game, the physical game, the power game, the skilled game. Good defense, good offense. Braden Holtby with an incredible season. How about the fact that Ovi put up 50 in his sleep? In his sleep. That's how complete they played.
And overslept once.
And perfectly handled. Nice. Well said. Well said. But perfectly handled, too. perfectly handled by Coach Trotz.
Yes.
So the coaching staff there in Washington, led by Coach Trotz, they all did an outstanding job. I've got Barry Trotz winning this one.
No argument here. Yeah. What an outstanding job by him. We're going to take time out. Those are the awards and what to watch for there. When we return, it's the offseason. There are going to be some busy teams. Weeksy breaks down the five teams to watch next. Welcome back to NHL Tonight. These are the key offseason dates. Board of Governors meeting, NHL Awards coming up, the draft in Buffalo, free agency July 1. You have that five-day window, so brace yourself for a busy July 1. Then the World Cup of Hockey, September 4. Training camps begin. How about the five teams to watch? Dallas Stars, we see coming at 5. Why?
Dallas Stars are going to have to really address the goaltending situation. They can score. They make plays. I love what Jim Neal has been able to build there, and they're on the right track right now. It was a really good season for Dallas, but they have to find a way to stabilize their net. That's just the bottom line. I think that both these guys were able to win 25 games. You look at them, they both played well individually at times, but it's simply just become too much of a story and too much uncertainty for the Dallas Stars. There are a lot of goalies that are available. Some might be via trade, maybe a couple via unrestricted free agency, but I wouldn't be surprised if the Dallas Stars either buy one of these guys out, do something, create some type of cap room, and go out and acquire another goalie. How about a guy like Marc-Andre Fleury? Are you able to swing a trade for Marc-Andre Fleury, bring him to Dallas? Could he be the last piece or one of the last pieces that they may need? We know what Jamie Benn's done. We know Seguin will be healthy, and Jason Spezza has been amazing. But I think that they need more. They've got to stabilize their net. So I wouldn't be surprised to see them active.
Gibson and Anderson, we touched on
exactly.
Earlier. Central Division Championship, a lot to feel good about for that
sure.
Team going forward. It's not the same for the Edmonton Oilers. 10 years in a row they've missed the playoffs. They come in at 4. What do you expect from them?
Peter Chiarelli is going to have to be extremely, extremely creative in what he does. Now, there's some talk that Neil Yakupov, Ryan Nugent Hopkins, and or Taylor Hall are available. Now, in the case of Taylor Hall, he's an all-star. I really love what I've seen from Taylor Hall. He had an incredible season. And Yakupov, to his credit, played much better this season when paired with Connor McDavid until the McDavid injury. But they've got a bevy of young forwards up front. I think it's time for the Edmonton Oilers to be able to leverage one of those young forwards, get a key defenseman back in return. They also have the 4 overall pick in the draft. How will that incorporate into their overall plan in terms of either drafting or maybe trading that pick for somebody else? So Pete Chiarelli's already built a winner. I wouldn't be surprised to see the Edmonton Oilers be very, very active, and their phones are burning up off the hotlines right now up in Edmonton.
All three of those guys, former 1 overall picks. How about the New York Rangers? 94 their last cup, and we know how much of a hunger there is for Henrik Lundqvist to win a cup. What's next for the Broadway Blue Shirts?
Well, I think it's time for Jeff Gorton to really, now that he has the reins as a general manager, to even have more of an imprint on the look and feel of this team. And we know that Jeff Gorton's done an incredible job with the team prior to being the GM, but I think it's time for Rick Nash to be moved. And there's been some talk, of course, that they're looking to move him. They're entertaining some offers potentially to move him. Could Derek Stepan be a guy that's potentially on the move? There's also some interest in him. How about on the back end? Would a Staal or a Girardi be a movable piece? I'd like to think they could net a better return with Staal than they could Danny Girardi at this point. And both those guys have been amazing warhorses for the Rangers on the blue line. Make no mistake about it, they give you everything they have. They've played through injury. But for the New York Rangers, they want to get younger, they want to get faster, and they need to. And I think when you look at some of the aforementioned, those are some of the guys that can give them the best return, potentially net them that best return and allow them the flexibility to get younger and get some faster, younger players. And, oh, by the way, maybe just try to take a run at Steven Stamkos if possible.
And what they want to do is reload, not rebuild. The Toronto Maple Leafs are in the midst of a rebuild, but boy, did they get a shot in the arm by getting the 1 pick in the draft. They're going to get a great player at the top of the draft. How about their outlook? They're 2 on your list. What do you see happening there?
I think the Toronto Maple Leafs are going to continue to follow their course that they've set in place, blueprint for the Leafs. Make no mistake about it. That's what they want to stay disciplined to. But in saying that, take a look at all these draft picks. Now, you factor in, okay, outstanding picks in Willie Nylander. Okay. Not to mention Mitch Marner, CHL Player of the Year. Okay. He was incredible, too, for the London Knights, and they won the Mem Cup.
My goodness.
Right. But on the verge is this young man right here. Austin Matthews, so impressed with meeting him and him coming on our NHL Network set in Stanley Cup Final at San Jose. He's a man already. He played against men. He dominated against men in the Swiss Elite League, which is a very, very good league, by the way. And his composure, his build, his mindset, all those things. We've spoken to Shane Doan. Shane Doan's been raving about him for years. I also think that the Toronto Maple Leafs may not necessarily be as far away in their rebuild as people may recognize. They have two first-round picks. I believe they've got, of course, one and then 30, if I'm not mistaken, at the end of that first round. They have a bevy of draft picks in this upcoming draft. And just some of the players and the picks that they already have and they've already made, like a Marner, like a Kasperi Kapanen, like a Willie Nylander, pretty remarkable cast that they have there right now and that they're building around on a go-forward basis. Teams know that, so teams are going to be trying to entice them to maybe one of those existing picks that they have or prospects or maybe somebody from the current roster, potentially speaking, as well. Does somebody try to pry loose one of their players? But the Toronto Maple Leafs are in a really nice seat right now, and they have to make good strategic decisions now that can impact their future.
There's a Toronto area kid who may be the most coveted UFA ever. Steven Stamkos, the Tampa Bay Lightning, number one on your list, and everybody understands why. What happens next for Yzerman and the Bolts?
I'm not so sure. I know cooler heads may prevail, and they certainly have prevailed in the latter half of the season. Steven Stamkos, when you look at him and what he's meant to this team, as the same situation we could say with Ben Bishop. Both key pieces, both of them. Ben Bishop brought by way of a trade by Steve Yzerman. Outstanding trade from the Ottawa Senators. Steven Stamkos, an original draftee. I called it Stampa Bay for a long time, but I'm not sure if they're going to replace the S and just keep the T as it's known on the world map. Either way, I look at both of these guys, both of them have had a major imprint. Now, in the case of Bishop, if they do end up trading him, that's going to give them some flexibility. And, of course, they have Vasilevsky lying in waiting, who I think is a superstar, potentially. Now, if they're also, if they do trade Ben Bishop, does that allow them more cap dollars to be able to make a harder run at Steven Stamkos? I think so. But you also have to look at Kucherov, Victor Hedman. You can go up and down the line. They need some of the other key foundational pieces signed as well. So this is the fireworks. Everybody's looking to see what's going to happen in Tampa. July 1's around the corner.
It isn't just player movement. There's coach movement. There are broadcasters who become coaches, like our colleague Scott Stevens, now of the Minnesota Wild. Interviewed today. Let's listen.
Hopefully I can help and help in winning here and hopefully teaching the young guys everything I've learned over the years. I love this game, and I like to give back. And if I can help the defense to reach their potential, certain players and, you know, even the older guys, Ryan Suter, you never stop learning this game. And I hope Ryan, there's room to grow. I'm sure there is. And I can learn from the players also, so it's very exciting.
That team got itself an elite hockey mind and a man who eats about 1,400 calories a day. It's unbelievable how disciplined that guy is. To this day.
A coup.
Oh.
That's a coup. Not a Kuna Matata. A coup. That's a coup. C-O-U-P. That's a coup in signing Scott Stevens. And let me tell you something. We're not going to break yet. Let me tell you this for free. Listen to me, Tone. Get it together. Unreal move by the Minnesota Wild. And if I'm a member of that Wild team, all I want to do, like we did here, is be around Scotty, be a sponge, listen to what he has to say. Hall of Famer, one of the best all time, played the game in every way, and was in the NHL since he's 18 years old. Any questions?
No, Mufasa. Right, we're going to go to a commercial break. Good. That's unbelievable.
Take
instead
it away.
Of Hakuna Matata.
Take it away, Tom.
When we come back, what would you wait 54 years for? Rangers fans waited for that image. We're coming right back. Rangers fans can tell you why June 14th is a significant date in franchise history. It is the anniversary of their last Cup win. The 94 Cup, it was a 54-year wait. That's a long time. Weeksy, is there anything you can think of that you'd be willing to wait 54 years for? That's like more than half a century.
Yeah, well, I played and lived in the U.S. for the last 21 years, parts of the last 21 years. Ketchup chips!
Oh, my goodness.
Come on!
No way.
As a native Canadian, ketchup chips!
Oh, yes.
Are you kidding me? Oh, my God.
Yes.
That's what we need to have here. Hey, who built that? I love that.
Surrounded by chips.
And by the way, I'm all out of my stock, too. So all
That's
the Canadian
awesome.
Players out there, you know what I'm talking about.
You know I would wait for the U.S. beating Canada in the Olympics in hockey. Oh, yes!
Yes!
Look at the podium.
70. Hey. Look at Weak C.
I like the first graphic. What's up with the second
one? That's awesome.
Come on.
Now, earlier in the show, there was a bit of a brain cramp for you. Do you remember?
Yeah, I do.
Let's watch this.
Let's see. They
don't play a fast game. And one person that helped them push the pace to play the fast game in...
Anaheim. In Anaheim, Lloyd, easy for me to say, and Carl Hagelin.
It was a brain freeze.
Oh, the slushy.
It was the snow cones that
Pulled
we had in Anaheim.
Over from San Jose.
Hear me? Anaheim, San Jose.
San Jose.
Oh, my gosh. Plug me in. I'm done. I'm out of juice. Plug me in. Somebody plug me in already. I'm not ready for the show.
Good night.
I'm not ready.